Revelation chapter 19. How many people love weddings? Anybody here love weddings? They grabbed it already, think David. They got it already. Okay, thank you. I love weddings. I love officiating at weddings. I've had a chance to do a number of weddings. I cannot keep track, but I love doing weddings. I've done a couple just in this last month. And by the way, in a couple days, Jeremy and Lindsay Mills are celebrating their 1 month anniversary. Got married last month. And so we haven't officially congratulated you guys. So congratulations. I'm sorry that took us so long, but we kind of forgot about that. But we had a great time at their wedding, and we're excited for you guys. But I love doing weddings. You know, one thing I also really love, and maybe some of you guys do, that's getting more and more popular, is on the internet seeing wedding fails. Anybody ever seen those? Yes. Well, I have a soft spot for watching these kinds of things. Let's see what we got here. Same volume. Oh, that was a doozy. Oh, yeah, so I'm sparing you from that, guys. You can just imagine what happened next. It wasn't very glorious for that groom. But let me tell you, we are going to be talking about a wedding today, and it is one that is going to be void of any fails. It is one that's going to be void of any mishaps. In fact, there is going to be a glorious wedding in store for all of us. And we're going to be getting into that here in Revelation chapter 19, as we look at this message, here comes the bridegroom. Usually the emphasis is on the bride, isn't it? Here comes the bride. It's all about the bride. We don't care about the groom. Groom, just sit over on the side. Just, you know, stand there. It's all about the bride, isn't it? But this wedding, the emphasis, the focus is going to be on the bridegroom, and we're going to be talking about who that is. I'm sure you already know, but let's get into this verse one. This is a great chapter. Because as we are going to see, we're going to be turning a corner a little bit here as from what we've been seeing so far in Revelation. Look at verse 1. After these things, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her. So right off the bat, we see a chronological development or turning point that's happening here, because we see those words, again, metatauta in the Greek, which we've seen through the book Revelation, after these things. Metatauta, after these things. Well, after what things? Well, after these things reveals that we're dealing with the time after what we've just read about, specifically in chapter 18 and prior to that. That was the judgment and the destruction of economic and commercial Babylon in chapter 18. Chapter 17 dealt with religious Babylon. These two entities, these two powers or systems that were at work giving power to the Antichrist kingdom. But these two things, religious Babylon, commercial Babylon, were also indicative of the worldly systems that are and has always been in opposition to God. And so we saw in chapter 17 and 18 that these were being judged. These two Babylons, religious Babylon, commercial Babylon, have been dealt with. They've been taken down, destroyed. Religious Babylon was defeated by the Antichrist, who destroyed her, devoured her, as well as the kings that were working with them. Chapter 18, commercial Babylon was taken down by an act of God, right? Now, religious Babylon in chapter 17 and the destruction of it brought us to the midway point of the tribulation, that 7-year period where the church has been raptured up to heaven, is with the Lord, and God is once again directly intervening in the affairs of the world and dealing again with his people Israel and still gathering people to salvation in him. So that's happening at the midway point of tribulation, the destruction of religious Babylon. Commercial Babylon brought us all the way to the end of the 7-year tribulation period. So what do we see? This judgment of God has been finalized now. It's come to an end. We've come ourselves now to the end of the tribulation period. Aren't you glad for that, guys? We're moving, you see, now. We're turning a corner, moving from judgment to look at what God now has in store for all of eternity. Aren't you glad for that, guys? Come on. Aren't you glad for that now, guys? Or do you want me to hang out in judgment a little longer? Judgment a little longer, or let's move on to what God has in store. Okay, let's move on. All right. Listen to what J. Vernon McGee says here. In chapter 19, we turn the page to that which marks a drastic change in the tone of Revelation. The destruction of Babylon, the capital of the beast kingdom, the Antichrist, marked the end of the great tribulation. The somber gives way to the song. The transfer is from darkness to light, from the inky blackness of night to a white light, from dreary days of judgment to bright days of blessing. This chapter makes a definite bifurcation in the book of Revelation and ushers in the greatest event for the earth, or this earth, the second coming of Christ to the earth to establish his kingdom. It is the bridge between the great tribulation and the millennial kingdom that he will establish upon this earth. That's what we are now moving into, and I'm so grateful for that. This is a great chapter here, as all of them have been, but there's a whole different tone to this now. So John hears in verse 1, a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven. This is not one voice, but this is a vast crowd in heaven now that's all shouting jubilantly and triumphantly. Now, who are these people, this great multitude? Well, we're going to get to that in a second. But what we do see is this heavenly choir giving praise to the Lord. That's what that word hallelujah means. We've all heard that word before, I'm sure, haven't we? We all say hallelujah. And sometimes we have words in our vocabulary that we really don't even know the definite definition of that. What exactly does that mean? I don't know, but it sounds good. I know I'm not wrong when I say hallelujah. And people are like, yeah, all right, hallelujah. So it's a good word, but we sometimes don't know what these words really mean. Well, listen, hallelujah, hallelujah comes from the Hebrew word hallel. And hallel simply means praise. We have in the Psalms, Psalm 113 to 118 are known as the hallel Psalms. Many believe that when Jesus had the Last Supper with his disciples, as they departed from there and they sung hymns as they left, that many believe he's reading from or singing one of these Psalms, these hallel or praise psalms. Now, in the Greek, it's alleluia. And we typically transliterate that into English as, of course, hallelujah or alleluia. We're trying to help some French people here. We're just dropping the H and just going alleluia because it's easier, right? Denis, can I get an amen? Where are you? Okay. Denis, there you are. Okay, good. All right. So, English, of course, now we get hallelujah, hallel, praise, Yahweh or Jehovah. It shortened Yah, of course. And so all this simply is, again, that expression, praise the Lord. Here's what the people in heaven, this vast multitude, is singing out in heaven. Hallelujah, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. It's interesting that hallelujah here is only used 4 times in the New Testament. And guess what? It's all right here in Revelation 19. This is the only place in the New Testament that you'll see that word, alleluia or hallelujah. If ever there was a hallelujah chorus, it's right here in Revelation chapter 19, our text here this morning. And they're singing alleluia, not just because it's kind of the right thing to do. Well, we're in heaven, and I guess, you know, what are we going to do? It's hallelujah. Can't go wrong with that, right? No, they're singing hallelujah. They're singing out praise the Lord for a very specific purpose and reason. Notice here what we read on there in verse 1. Hallelujah. Salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. The very fact that we have been saved, my friends, is reason enough for us to worship and to praise the Lord daily, continuously, without ceasing. Oh, I understand you might go through hard times, difficult days. You might go through trials and hard circumstances, but understand that you are saved and a child of God, that he has delivered you from this world and from your sin. And it's reason for us in all circumstances to say, praise the Lord. Amen? Praise the Lord. And I like this here because not only are they singing, you have saved us, but there's different phases or stages even to our salvation. Because we have been saved from the penalty of our sin. That's done, all right? Sin no longer holds anything against us. We've been forgiven of sin. We're saved from the penalty of sin. And we are currently being saved from the power of sin. All right? That's that sanctification process. We are being saved from the power of sin presently. Guess what? There's a day coming when we're not just going to be saved or be able to look back and say we've been saved from the penalty of sin and the power of sin, but there's coming a day when we'll be able to say, I have been saved from the presence of sin. There's no longer any sin to worry about. There's coming a day, and guess what? These people are experiencing that right here. In Revelation 19, verse 1, they're singing out, hallelujah, praise the Lord, for salvation belongs to our God. Oh, and he has delivered me from the penalty, from the power, and now I'm not experiencing even the presence of sin. Glory be to God. That day is coming, guys. I'm excited about that. And it will be all due to his glory and honor. And in it, God shows his power. That's all what they're praising the Lord for. You deserve all the glory, all the honor. It's not because of us. We couldn't have done anything about it, Lord. It's all because of you and your power. You alone are able to defeat sin and deliver me out of that. You alone, Jesus. So you deserve all praise and glory. That is so awesome. And the fact that Babylon, that harlot that has led so many into sin, the fact that she's been destroyed, God is displaying, again, that great power in doing so. Another reason they will give praise to the Lord is, notice what we read there in verse 2, because true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication and has avenged on her the blood of a servant shed by her. True and righteous are his judgments, it says in verse 2. That's another reason to praise the Lord. It's funny that the world decries the judgment of God, or rather the lack of it. Oh, they say, if there was really a God, then why is there evil in the world? Why are things just going on as they are? And it gives people that excuse to not follow after God, or an apparent excuse to not follow after God. If there was a God, then why are all these things happening? Yet the world never wants to be accountable for the wrongs they do. What does the world say? Hey, don't judge me. You don't know me. Don't judge. They don't want to be held accountable to that standard of judgment. And yet they blame God. They decry God. They dismiss God because they don't see him carrying out any kind of judgment against the evils of this world, apparently. So they paint themselves in a corner, don't they? They blame God for not acting, but neither do they want to be held to that standard that would see them judged for their own wrongdoing. Very interesting. In a time where people question the fairness of God, let me share with you guys that a day is indeed coming when we will see the final judgment of God, and we'll declare that he is completely true, right, and fair in his judgment. Oh, God, man, I didn't see how that was all going to pan out. I didn't see how that was all going to work about. But God, as I've seen you do your work, true and righteous are your judgments. What can I say? I can't say anything against you, God, because you do everything well. You do everything perfect. True and righteous are your judgments. We certainly don't see that in our world today. We don't even see that among one another. We don't always see fair or right judgment being passed down in the world. Justice doesn't always get carried out justly in courts today. And the problem we encounter is when we try to rule over or provide justice, is that we don't always have the facts straight. we get conflicting testimonies. Maybe you've been there with kids, and I'll have a child come to me and say, hey, do you know what my brother just did to me? And I'm like, what? And I'm like, that's it, man. I go stomp. I'm like, rah, rah, rah. And then they'll be like, well, but they did this to me first. And I'm like, oh, what? Oh, I'm sorry. And then I go back, what? And then I go back and I start yelling at this person or talking graciously to them. Like, what? You didn't tell me all of that. And they'll be like, no, well, they did this. And then I don't have all the information. And I'm ready to throw out judgment based on something I hear. And then I realize I don't have all my facts straight. You see, maybe you've been there. Maybe it's just me. But we have a hard time putting out judgment, you see. But when God drops the gavel down, he will do so knowing all the facts and details. And it goes deeper even to the secret motives of the heart. God knows everything. And he knows how to execute true and right judgment. To where nobody will be able to say, that's not right, Lord, that's not fair. He will do everything well. And one day we'll clearly understand that even if we don't fully understand it all now, there will come a day when we will fully understand all that he's done and all that he's doing, and that it is right and true. But our response is always to be that of walking in praise. What's our response to the Lord? What's our response to the Lord? Are we able to praise the Lord when things aren't making sense? Are we able to praise the Lord when we are going through trials? Are we able to praise the Lord even in the midst of tragedy? See, the reality in each of these circumstances is that God, as we're seeing here, is still on the throne. He is still ruling over all, and the day is soon coming when he will sovereignly intervene and bring about his justice once and for all. And if we can just keep that perspective and realize that as dark as these days get in Christ, we keep getting pulled out of darkness and into that light. As Paul says in Romans 8:18, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Regardless of how difficult your days might be or tomorrow might be, there is coming a day when we will say, Lord, that was nothing. It was all worth it. Because now that we are in your glory, I see that this far outweighs every trial and hardship I experienced, Lord. It's reason enough, isn't it, for us to remain rejoicing, to be persistent in praise, to not weary in worship? It's enough, isn't it, to know who God is, what he's done for us, what he continues to do, and what is still to come. It's enough for me to continue on remaining rejoicing, persistent in praise, not wearying in worship. And so, here they are again, singing out. This isn't a one verse, one chorus kind of a song. It's something we just won't get tired saying or singing. Notice they continue on. Verse 3, again they said, Alleluia! Her smoke rises up forever and ever, and the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who sat on the throne, saying, Amen. Alleluia. Praise the Lord. Why? Because again, as we've already seen many reasons, another reason, Babylon's smoke rises up forever and ever. Does this mean there's going to be a smoking section in heaven after all? No, that's not the case. This simply shows us and reveals to us that this judgment and destruction of Babylon is final. It's never going to be rebuilt, never going to be restored. This system that opposes God is never going to raise its ugly head again. Smoke rises up forever and ever. There will no longer be a seductress emerging out of her ashes, seeking to tempt or trouble anyone anymore. And guys, that's reason again to rejoice and sing out Alleluia. So here we see mentioned once more, 24 elders and the four living creatures. They were introduced for us in Revelation chapter 4. The 24 elders represented the church. That's us. So we're a part of this hallelujah chorus going on in chapter 19. Just imagine, right now as we're reading this, chapter 19, all these things that are going down, that's going to be us that's up there singing this. How cool is that? And the four living creatures, as we saw in Revelation 4, as Ezekiel recorded for us, these were cherubim, a class of angels. So this group is falling down in awe and praise before God. And we don't just say, hallelujah, but we say, amen, hallelujah, amen, praise the Lord. That's an important word being added. Amen literally means so be it. So be it. It speaks of a strong agreement. It means absolutely, firmly. This statement is faithfully true. It's when Jesus would say, verily, verily, I say unto you, he means this is a firm statement being given. You can depend on this. This is trustworthy. Verily, verily. If someone were to say, Pastor Brent sure is the bomb, right? You'd naturally say, hey, true dat, or amen. That's true, yeah. Nah, that's maybe not the right analogy to use. But Pastor Brent sure is humble. Amen. Okay, no, that doesn't work either. So, it's more fitting to say amen after a statement of truth after it is a prayer. And I'm not trying to say, oh, eliminate saying amen after prayer because we are agreeing with what has been said. But it's more right to use amen after a statement has been given. After someone says, let's continue on praising the Lord. Amen. So be it. That's right. True dat. Indeed. So we, the church and the angelic representatives, are all agreeing with all that's been said already, with all the heavenly voices that are worshiping the Lord. We're all together saying, yeah, man. Oh, that's good. Yes, indeed. Right on. Yes. Amen. But we're not done yet. Look at verse 5 then. A voice came from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants and those who fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thunderings, saying, alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. So a voice now comes from the throne. Most likely this is one of the angels serving at the throne of God. And he commands all of God's servants and all who fear him, both small and great, it says, to praise him. Hey guys, praise the Lord. Let's do it. This group could be a reference to those still on the earth who come to faith during the tribulation. It could be speaking of all the tribulation saints who have not yet either been killed or died off. They're still on the earth. And so all of God's servants, whether you are small or great, the call is going out, whether it's in heaven or on earth, let's praise the Lord. And then the great multitude sings out again. This great multitude, as seen in verse 1, again now is speaking of all of God's people, the church, tribulation saints that are in heaven, that are on earth, the angels, all those that are following and serving Jesus. This great multitude, this heavenly choir, is singing out, and their song of praise, it says, was like the sound of many waters. Anybody ever stood by Niagara Falls? Yeah? I have not done that yet. I would love to do that one day. But I can just imagine the sound. Those of you that were there, it's probably just a sound that is just roaring. It's commanding that kind of authority, isn't it? Right? Someone has been there? Help me out? You're all like, oh, no, actually, it was really quite timid and mild there, Brent. Move on, Brent. That's what it would be like roaring. I've been by other waterfalls, and it's commanding. This voice of many waters, just imagine that, standing by Niagara Falls. And it was also likened to the sound of mighty thunderings. Man, we've all been in thunderstorms. I love being in thunderstorms. And it's just bang, just powerful. And here's this heavenly choir singing out, and there's power behind it. There's just this commanding voice behind it. I'm just getting goosebumps thinking about it right now. I don't know about you, but think about this day that we're going to be a part of that. Imagine we're going to be in this choir and we're going to be singing, alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. He reigns. Omnipotent means that he's all powerful. There's nobody greater. Nobody stronger. He is all powerful. He's got all strength, you see. And the fact that he is not just omnipotent, but the Lord God omnipotent reigns. In other words, he's all powerful. He is in charge. He's ruling and reigning. There is none other. And so all praise is his. Handel's Messiah, of course. That great hallelujah chorus comes right from here. for the Lord. I just want to sing it, you know, but I'm going to spare you from that. You guys can sing it. I'll take a minute. No. Okay, we'll leave it. But here's the thing. This angel is simply saying, hey, praise the Lord. You know, sometimes we need to just simply remind ourselves to be people of praise. Sometimes we can get ourselves into just such a funk over stuff we're going through and dealing with, and life can get hard. This world isn't easy. But we need to remind ourselves. Just praise the Lord. Whether we feel like it or not, because he's worthy of it, you see. He's deserving of it. He's omnipotent. He reigns. He's got something glorious in store. This is not our home. We talked about that last week. We're just passing through on our way to our true home in heaven, where we are going to be taking part in praise. And let me tell you, when you are in that funk, it's like David in Psalm 42, why so downcast, O my soul? Put your hope in God, for all you have praise of my Savior and my God. David has to have a little pep talk with himself. What's the matter with you, David? What are you doing, man? You're all wallowing about like Eeyore here. Pick yourself up, man. Praise the Lord. He's deserving of it. Put your hope in God. I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. We need to do that at times. We need to encourage one another to do that. Oh, I'm not trying to sweep the reality under the rug. No, we need to bear with one another. And those burdens, we need to come alongside one another. But instead of having a pity party, we need to have more praise parties. Say, hey, let's get our focus back on the Lord. If I'm not prone to worship, then I need to check my heart. Perhaps I've allowed some root of bitterness to grow, or maybe I'm harboring, hiding some sin. Maybe I've just grown apathetic or distracted. Whatever the reason, when opportunities arise to worship the Lord, and I take them lightly or act indifferent towards them, my heart then is being revealed in that. See, guys, we've been created to worship. We've been created to worship. Are we fulfilling that? Though you may go through hard times, man, yeah, we want to come alongside and pray for you. We want to address those things. We want to help and encourage. But one of the greatest things we can do is begin to praise the Lord, because that's what we've been created to do. And when we're walking in that will of the Father in worship of our God, we begin to see how great he is and how little these issues in life really are. Begin to get that proper eternal perspective again. Now, if you're still needing a little motivation to be a worshiper, hey, guess what? We've got more for you. All right? Look at verse 7 with me. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. We're called here to be glad and to rejoice. Why? Because the marriage of the Lamb has come. The marriage of the Lamb, who's the Lamb? It's Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Interesting that he chooses to identify himself through eternity as that Lamb. A great reminder for us of why we're able to go to heaven. It's through his sacrifice. He laid his life down on the cross to bring us in through the forgiveness of sin, through life in him. So this is Jesus we're talking about. Guys, he is the bridegroom. And the best part is, we're his bride. His wife has made herself ready. That's us, the church, the bride of Christ. We're his wife. All those that have put their trust in Jesus right from Pentecost to the rapture. That makes up the church, this bride of Christ that he died for. Hey guys, there's many great relationships found in the Word of God that God uses to illustrate his relationship with us. We have creator and creature, master to servant, shepherd to sheep. That's so fitting, isn't it? Father and child. But nothing is as special nor as intimate as that of a husband and wife. And it's what Jesus chooses to illustrate, that relationship between him and us. Speaks of us as that bride How precious is that? And notice, like we read there in verse 7, his wife has made herself ready. His wife has made herself ready. Are we making ourselves ready to meet Jesus and be with Jesus? Well, what does that mean? What does that look like? How do we make ourselves ready? By waiting, by watching, by living pure lives set apart for Christ, that when he comes again, ready to say, Lord, there's nothing holding me back. There's nothing defiling me that would cause any kind of problem in this relationship. Living pure. And notice there's a wonderful balance that we see here. Because we see man's responsibility. We have us here seeking to live pure lives, to live set apart from this world and set apart for God. Notice what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. For I'm jealous for you with godly jealousy, for I've betrothed you to one husband that I might present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. That's our part. That's making ourselves ready, that we might be a chaste virgin set apart to Christ. Paul says, oh man, I have been longing for you. I'm jealous for you with godly jealousy, that you, the church, might be set apart and presented to Christ in that way. So we see man's responsibility, but we also have God's responsibility here. Notice there in verse 8, to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For her it was granted. In other words, that's something that we need to be given. Man's part is to keep ourselves ready, waiting, set apart. But God's part is saying, I'm gonna clothe you here. I'm gonna grant you to be arrayed in fine linen. In other words, guys, we don't come based on our own works. We approach God based on his cleansing for us. We are made righteous through faith in Jesus Christ. Too many times I talk to people that say, yeah, I'm going to heaven. Well, why are you going to heaven? Well, because I live a good life. I try to do good things. I try to be a good person. That's great and all. Keep at it. But your works will never be enough. The Bible says that our own righteousness is as filthy rags before God. It's never enough, you see. We cannot approach God by our own works. We need to be granted to be arrayed in fine linen. We need to take that righteousness of Christ that he's given us, that he's provided for us. We need to literally put on Jesus Christ, clothe ourselves in Christ and his righteousness. And that's a work of grace. That's a work that Jesus does for us free of charge. We can't earn it. We can't achieve it. We just simply have to receive it. Receive it by repenting of our sin, turning from our former way of life and saying, man, this is going the wrong way, Jesus. I need to repent. I need to change direction. I need to turn to you. I need to receive what you have for me, Jesus. Jesus does that work for us. Look what else Paul says for us in Ephesians 5, verse 25 to 26. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. Again, there we see that dynamic of the relationship between husband and wife. This is speaking of Christ and the church. And that's what Paul says in Ephesians 5. It was a mystery, but I speak regarding Christ and the church. Jesus is doing the work for us. Yeah, man has a part in being ready, abiding in Christ, but God also gives us that righteousness in and through Jesus Christ. I love how the idea is this fine linen. You know, the priests were to wear linen because linen was a fabric that was breathable. In other words, the work of the priest was not to be a sweat, you see. He wasn't supposed to be clothed in attire that was just a burden. And he's like sweating. God provided something that would be an ease for him. It wasn't to be a labor. He wasn't to sweat it out. In the same way, you see, we're not to sweat for our salvation. It's done and complete in Christ. Nevertheless, listen, we're going to be judged for our faithfulness in service to the Lord. Not judged for salvation, but for reward. And so this is now the righteous acts of the saints. Are we carrying those out? Our wedding garment will apparently be of our own making based on our acts. Interesting. Now, continuing on in this idea of a wedding. A wedding in Jewish culture was the best banquet or party that was thrown, right? It was always a reason for celebration and great joy. In fact, David Guzik says this, according to rabbinical teaching, obedience to the commandments was suspended during a wedding celebration if obeying a commandment might lessen the joy of the occasion. Hey, if you follow the law is going to hinder you in celebrating and having joy, then just, you know, let that go. Just kind of lighten the reins a little bit here. Just, man, you celebrate. You get down, you get funky, you do what you need to do, and you just have a good time, right? This is a party. This is a celebration. This is a cause for great joy. That's the wedding in Jewish culture. Now, let's take a look here at the phases of a Jewish wedding here in John's day. All right? Because this is a great study as well. First of all, you have the betrothal, okay? Betrothal happened by typically the parents arranging the wedding, all right? So yeah, these were fixed marriages in a sense, right? I like the idea. I'm still for it. Trying to tell my kids we got it all planned out. You don't need to worry about all that. Skip the dating thing. When you're ready, I've got bride or groom ready for you. They're not quite on board with it yet, but we'll work on it. But I like that idea. So the father of the groom would come with that dowry, the price of the bride, and he would bring that to the father of the bride. They would work out the arrangements, the term and everything like that. And so at that point now, when that was all worked out and arranged, the couple were now considered legally married. Just the betrothal. It's important to note that the price set for the bride was based on the father's wealth. God, having all resources at his disposal, offered us, his bride, the most precious gift in his son. And it was based, secondly, on the bride's worth. There was a story of an Arabian man who had one daughter, very plain, and he doubted if anyone would want to marry her. When word came to him one day that a man in a distant village was smitten with her, and he was on his way with an offer for his daughter, well, the father was prepared to take the first price that was given, but was completely surprised when the price of 6 cows was offered. 6 cows, he thought, in shock. The most anyone has been given in this village was 3 cows. So without hesitation, of course, the father sent his daughter off with her new husband. 2 years later, the daughter and her husband returned to her home village, and everyone was startled by this bride's exquisite beauty. How was she so beautiful, the crowds wondered. Because her husband saw her as worth 6 cows, and a 6-cow beauty she became. You see, that's just it with us, isn't it? You are much more worth or of worth in the eyes of the Lord than we oftentimes think. You may feel like an outcast, a reject. You might feel unaccepted at times, but you're far more valuable than you often realize. You're loved and accepted, and Jesus has gone out of his way to show it. Understand the price that Jesus paid for you. I missed something, didn't I? Because everybody's kind of laughing. Did I miss something? Or you're worth more than a cow. Did I say that? Okay. You're worth more than that. You are. At least 7 cows, guys. 7 cows here. No. But the price that Jesus paid for you is incredible. And sometimes we walk around like, oh, man. Now, I'm not saying that, oh, we need to realize, oh, we're wonderful. We're great. But you're accepted in the beloved. He chose you. He saved you. He paid a great price for you. Understand that your worth is in Christ. So after the betrothal, we come to the engagement. The engagement would last a minimum of a year. It was the time where the bride-to-be was observed for her purity. It allowed at least 9 months to pass to make certain that the bride was a virgin at the time of the betrothal. Also, during this time, the groom would be away at his father's house, preparing a place, adding on a room to his father's house for him and his bride. Does that sound familiar? Remember what Jesus said in John 14, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So during the engagement, interestingly, the bride would stay at her home, in her father's home. The groom would be off, adding on to his father's house, preparing a place for his bride. And the bride would never know when exactly the groom would be coming for her. Would not have the exact day. It was when the father would inspect the place and see that all the details were worked out, that the room was all prepared and ready, and the father would send the groom away and say, all right, you're ready. It's time. Let's go and get that bride. So the bride had to be ready and waiting. It increased romantic anticipation, no doubt. Well, on the wedding day, the bridegroom would go get his bride, and they would form a procession back to the place he'd been preparing. That pictures for us the rapture of the church, because it happens at a time when we don't know, but we need to stay ready. And he's going to come and gather us to himself and bring us back to his father's house. Well, after the engagement came the formal wedding and the wedding feast. This would take place at the bridegroom's home. The bride and the groom would go back in, would go back to that place, and they'd go into a back room. It would be there that they would consummate the relationship, and the bride would stay hidden there for 7 days, where she'd be waited on hand and foot while the guests continued to party for those 7 days. And after those 7 days, the groom would present his new bride to his family and friends. The marriage feast would then begin. Just like a wedding today, oftentimes the wedding ends with, you know, the kissing of the bride and groom, and they make their way down the aisle. Everybody kind of, oh, wonderful, great. And then the bride and groom kind of disappear for a bit. They're off getting pictures. The wedding party goes off to the reception, hoping that there's some refreshments there to snack on while the bride and groom are busy getting pictures, waiting for them to show back up, you see. This is kind of what's going on here in this wedding feast, but for 7 days, they're kind of snacking, you know, on cheese and crackers and everything like that, right? And they're hanging out, waiting for that 7 day period to end when the bride would be brought out and introduced. This is why the marriage supper of the Lamb is introduced at the end of Revelation. Because we are living in the engagement period right now. We're growing in knowledge of Jesus at this present time. We're waiting for his return. We don't know when it's going to come, but he'll come unexpectedly, and he's going to call us out. Are you ready? Are you waiting? And we're going to be raptured up, caught up with him in the clouds. The marriage is completed. We'll return to his home where we will be not for 7 days, but for 7 years. What a honeymoon it's going to be, guys. But we'll be presented after those 7 years as his glorious bride as we come back to this earth with our bridegroom, Jesus Christ, which we'll get to later in chapter 19 next week. And we're going to come back with him and enjoy that marriage supper of the Lamb, possibly through all of the millennium. It's going to be glorious. It's going to be grand. This is what we have to look forward to, guys. And this is all illustrated so wonderfully and perfectly in the customs of the Jewish wedding. Verse 9 goes on to say, then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. Now, Jesus is the bridegroom we see in the church, of course, is the bride. But there's going to be others who will be a part of the celebration, others that will be invited in a different distinction. The 10 virgins that we saw in Matthew 20, 25 were guests in the wedding, at least the 5 that were ready. John the Baptist, he called himself the friend of the bridegroom, not the bride. So we see these differing groups through the kingdom age. This verse does not pertain here to the church. We don't need to be invited to our own wedding. We're a part of it. The church reigns with Christ, and they will have a distinct position with Christ. So these guests would be the rest of the saved, then outside of the church. Possibly Old Testament saints, tribulation martyrs who are in heaven, tribulation saints still on the earth who have been brought in now at that second coming. And I fell at his feet to worship him, verse 10. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So John is just so caught up in joy and adoration and praise that he just can't help himself. And he just falls down. He just falls down and he begins to worship. He just wants to worship. But he's worshiping an angel. And notice what the angel says. He says here, see that you do not do that. See that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren. Now, if you got a New King James Bible like I do here, you'll see that there's a lot of italics there. And the italics was given when the translators were looking to give better sense in the English. But they're not there. Those words in the italics aren't there in the original Greek. They're supplied by the translator. But sometimes their attempts to help giving the sense obscures the emphasis in the Greek. Because what's happening here is the angel is really simply saying, see not. See not. That's all really the angel is saying. It's in the Greek, it's hora me. See not. In other words, this angel is giving a quick, intense, and punctuated command. It's like the angel is saying, what are you doing? Get up. Get up. You're going to get me in trouble here. People are watching. I can't receive this. You're going to get me in trouble. Get up. It's kind of what the angel is doing here. It's this emphatic, like, rush. He's not taking time. He's, oh, no, 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 John. It's okay. You don't need to do that. Come on up. It's like, get up. See not. And that's important because worship is only ascribed to God. God is the only one to be worshipped. Yet, in Revelation 1, John falls down before Jesus and worships him. Throughout the Gospels, we saw situations where people would come and fall down before Jesus to worship him. Did Jesus stop it like this angel? No. Jesus received worship. He received worship because he is God and is deserving of worship. Many today will claim that Jesus is just another angel. But angels would not receive worship. Jesus did, because Jesus is God, and he is worthy of our worship and praise. So the angel goes on to point John then to Jesus. Don't look at me. Don't worship me. He says, worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. That last phrase is an important one, because the heart and focus of all God-inspired prophecy is to do what? It's to promote the message of Christ Jesus. When we begin, or when we began this book, we saw that John called it the Revelation. The Revelation of what? The Revelation of the last days? Revelation of judgment? Revelation of catastrophe and earthquake and plagues? What was it? The Revelation of what? Jesus. Remember, it's not revelations, it's revelation, singular, because it's all about Jesus Christ. It's pointing people to Jesus because he is the spirit of all prophecy. It's all about Jesus. It's the revelation, the unveiling of Jesus Christ. We must ever bear in mind that all true prophecy aims at one thing, the exaltation of Christ and the promotion of the message of the gospel. If Bible prophecy, and there's a lot of people that, man, they're all about Bible prophecy, and that's not a bad thing, because the spirit of it's about Jesus, like we're seeing. But there are some people that can tend to go to the extremes. And if Bible prophecy begins to distract us into watching Fox News more than we're setting our eyes on Jesus, then there's a problem. If we're becoming judgmental towards the world instead of being more passionate for the lost because of prophecy, then there's a problem. Because the heart of prophecy, the spirit of prophecy, is about Jesus. We should be growing in Jesus, becoming more in love with Jesus as we go through prophecy, having a greater anticipation to be with Jesus, and simply desiring to make Jesus known. That's what prophecy should be motivating us in. This is why the book of Revelation is so exciting, why it's such a tragedy when churches don't want to open up the book of Revelation. Because it's all about Jesus. Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Let's continue on in the things of Jesus. Guys, he is coming soon. Let's be watching, waiting, ready for his unexpected return at the rapture. Oh, it's coming soon. Hey, tonight's the blood moon, isn't it? The fourth blood moon. That's it. That's it. It's over. It's the last one. I'm sorry we're not going to finish Revelation 19. Listen, meet me in heaven off in the east corner. We'll finish up Revelation 19 together in heaven because we won't be here next week. Fourth blood moon's coming tonight. All right. But see, we can get crazy, can't we, in our views and what prophecy can cause us to do. But may we stay grounded and remain in Christ and realize that it's all about Christ. Everything that we look at, prophecy related, we try too hard to try to fit the puzzle together. Ooh, did you see what Iran's doing with Russia? Oh, did you see what's happening over here? Oh, that's it. That's going to be it. That's it. And we can get carried away. Hey, I'm not against looking at things and seeing that, oh, this could be that. Oh, this is interesting developments going on. But God's got it all in his hand. And he's working out his plan perfectly. And so let me just stay in Jesus, watching and ready, waiting. That's enough for me. I hope it's enough for you. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for our time here together in your word and just how we can look here at this great passage. Here comes the bridegroom, Lord. May we be reminded that you are working out your plan of redemption and salvation, and that entails you coming back to gather your church. It's depicted for us so clearly and wonderfully in the phases of the Jewish wedding. Lord, right now you are preparing a place for us, and you're going to come and gather us to you that where you are, we might be also. Lord, that day is coming soon, and so may we be ready, watching, anticipating your return. May we be presenting ourselves, that chaste virgin before you, pure, holy, unadulterated, set apart from this world and set apart to you. But thank you, Lord, that we don't stand in our own righteousness. We stand in the righteousness of Jesus Christ that he provided for us on the cross. Lord, may we be clothed in that daily. So, Lord, thank you for prophecy. Thank you that we see these events in the world all shaping up, all according to your plan, your will. You're in charge of it all. And as we go through prophetic events and things that are coming down, I pray that it would just cause us all the more to look to you and to be settled in you and upon you and just abiding in Christ. That's our desire here. So strengthen us, Lord, in these things. Go with us, we pray, Jesus, in your name. Amen.